few weeks ago entitled Be Positive. Be Positive. And as I said earlier, thank you for taking the opportunity to be here with us. If you have your Bibles, if you're open up with me to Philippians chapter 4. Philippians 4. I want to hit a subject that is, I believe in reality, is a great struggle for all of us at various times in our lives, but I believe God's word gives us help. But I believe it begins with a right mindset, a right attitude, and overcoming what might be a struggle within our lives. And let me, before I get too far in this teaching this morning, it's more than just a power of positive thinking. That by no means is what I'm wanting the series to be about. It's godly thinking. It's godly attitudes by trusting in Jesus, by believing in Jesus, relying upon the work of Christ within our lives. But what I will tell you as I reflect in Him, I do have more positive thoughts. I do have a pure heart, a right heart, a right attitude in how I respond and how I choose to live my life. So we began this just a few weeks ago, and I spoke a couple weeks ago. Pastor Joe spoke last week on try it, you'll like it. I think one of the greatest thoughts that Pastor Joe gave us is let's not just present the problem, let's provide a solution to the problem. That's huge in today's world. It's one thing to say, hey, the toilet doesn't work. It's another thing to say, hey, do you have a new flapper so I can fix the toilet? You know what I mean? Yeah. Hey honey, the toilet won't stop running. You know, hey, friend, your toilet keeps running. Who knows what it is? Well, how do you fix a running toilet? We'll just put a new flapper on it. You know, that's a simple solution, but I don't know if you realize this, there are many solutions in life, many helps in life, and I believe it's important that we try to help one another, not just point out the problem, but how do we fix the problem that is there, amen? Amen. And I believe that God's word is a great place to go to help us. I could stand up here all day long and identify problems that we struggle with, but I think it would be wrong for me to identify the problem and not identify a help, a solution, in order to move us past the problems that so many of us face. And one of the difficulties that I want to present and have us focus on for just a moment is what I would say is the Christian answer to anxiety. Anxiety. I wonder, anybody ever have anxiety? Yeah. Anybody ever have worries in life? For those that didn't raise your hand, I have to believe that you might not be being truthful this morning. It's natural. We all have those experiences. I don't think I'm super Christian if I identify, well, I don't have those struggles. We have them. Any of you ever have, raise your hand if you have children. If you have lifted your hand and said you never had a worry, anxiety, I know you're not being truthful. That's what children do. If you have parents, your parents had worries and anxieties about you. You know what I mean? Yeah, it's just, it's what we go through. It's not, hear me, it's not that we're bad because we have a worry. It's not, we're not a bad person because we have anxiety. It's just, how do we respond to that? How do we deal with that? How do we overcome that within our lives? Anxiety, let me just give you a simple definition. I believe anxiety is a painful uneasiness of mind over an anticipated ill. One more time. A painful uneasiness of mind over an anticipated ill. It produces worry and disquietness. It robs peace of soul and any sense of tranquility that we might have. It takes a life otherwise joyous and secure and turns it into a prison of turmoil and distress. That's what anxiety does. Perhaps there's no other trouble more frequently that appears in the lives of believers than the struggle of anxiety. Anxiety. Yet I believe that God's word has answers. Answers to help us in those moments, in those feelings that we have. It's an answer that confronts us, catch this, with the exact image of what we are and with the means by which we may become what we ought to be. Hear this one more time. It confronts us with the exact image, I believe, of what we are and with the means by which we may become what we ought to be. The answer to anxiety. I don't believe this is some simple. I don't believe that this is some simple practice. I don't believe that this is some simple formula. Why? Because this is a struggle, and many people live in the pain of anxiety for days, for weeks, for months and years, just hoping to find some answer, hoping to find some solution to the turmoil of our lives. But I believe God's word helps us and gives us an answer that will work if we'll accept it and choose to live by it. The answer to anxiety. Look here in Philippians chapter 4. Pick up with me in the fourth verse. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Verse 5, let your gentleness be evident to all, for the Lord is near. Catch verse 6. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Continue with me a little bit further. Verse 8, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoice greatly in the Lord, verse 10, that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I am not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. And catch verse 13. I'm going to conclude here. The apostle states, I can do everything through him who gives me strength. Father, we say thank you for your word today. Lord, help us to receive your truth. God, help us to receive your right revelation. Lord, we want to be positive. We want to think rightly, godly. We want our hearts to demonstrate and to exhibit, Lord, what is right, pure, holy. Lord, so we ask for your help this morning. God, and may our lives be fertile soil to receive your truth. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. I want to give you some thoughts this morning, as I've just said, through God's word, as the Christian answer to anxiety. Number one, communion with God. Communion with God. Forgive me, I don't always do this, but I just want to move a little closer to you today. Church, we have to commune with God. Fellowship. Relate.
run after him, seek after him, because we realize that this is right.
Philippians 4:6 simply says, be anxious. Be anxious about nothing. Put it another way, do not be anxious about anything. Communion with God does a few things for us. Let me give you, I got three thoughts that communion with God does for us. Number one, communion with God makes you mindful of God's blessings. Of the blessings of God. That God's blessings, I believe, have met your need at every moment within your life. God's blessings should remove self-pity and worry. We recognize that God desires to bless us. I gain that as I walk in fellowship, as I walk in communion, knowing, recognizing the good of God within my life. Number two, communion with God affords you the privilege of request. Think about this. If Chris and I didn't have communion in a relationship, how could I present my request to him? It's difficult. Almost impossible. But if I have that communion, if I have that relationship, then I understand through that relationship that God's word simply says, catch this. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. God says it's okay. It's okay. Just ask. Just make that request known. It affords us that privilege. Through requests, I believe that we can unburden our soul. Catch this. Psalms 55, verse 22 states, cast your cares on the Lord, and he will sustain you. He will never let the righteous fall. How beautiful it is that he says, hey, just cast your cares. I want to know. I want you to release that burden. I want you to release that care. And trust that I'll take care of it, that I'll do what's right, I'll do what's good for your life. Through requests, we can obtain God's help. I believe that this is illustrated in the life of Moses, in the life of Jonah, in the life of the Apostle Paul. Think about this. Jonah had received the word of the Lord, received God's instruction, received God's appointment for his life. He walked in error, he walked in rebellion and got cast out of the ship down into the depths of the sea. Was swallowed up by the great fish. And why he's there in his despair, I would imagine why he's there filled with anxiety, thinking, how in the world am I ever going to get out of this? What does he do? He fellowships with God. He communes with God. He feels an openness to begin to make his requests known to God. And what does God do? He blesses him. He provides the help, the way out that he needs. The Apostle Paul sitting in prison, being beaten multiple times over, been shipwrecked, in despair after despair. I mean, when you find those moments of despair, naturally we're filled with the anxiety, but over and over again, we find the Apostle Paul crying out to God, calling out, making his request known. Why? Because he has that moment of communion. He understands that relationship, that continual relationship that he has. Communion with God affords us the privilege to make the request. I believe communion with God, thirdly, brings you peace. Peace. Look at verse 7. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Christ says it this way: my peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. So do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. John chapter 14. Peace. Peace. You know, there's just something peaceful about the presence of God. Communion with God. Fellowshipping with God. It's a guarding peace the apostle refers to, that he will guard your hearts
and your minds, according to Philippians chapter 7. By using this military metaphor, Paul represents the peace as that which is guarding the hearts, as a garrison holds a fortress at every inlet into their soul. This peace stands like an armed sentinel, keeping out the disturbing influences of the world into our lives. We need that peace of God. We need that peace of God to rule within our lives, our hearts. Why? It's that peace that acts as the guards, that keeps the heart from being corrupted, that keeps the heart to be filled with the Spirit, that keeps the heart from having those experiences of anxiety. We need that peace. And he says, as we make that request known, that he chooses to bless us with his presence that provides that peace into our lives. Communion with God brings peace. God's peace, as we often refer to, is that indescribable peace. It declares that it transcends all understanding. What does that mean? Just can't really put it into words, but when you have it, you know it. You know what I'm talking about? You seem so peaceful. Why are you at peace? Well, I have Jesus. I'm not trying to brag. Well, can you describe? No, I can't describe it. It just comes with Jesus. It's just that assurance. Why? Because we know who we are in Christ Jesus. We know who Jesus is. We know what he did, what he provides. As we cast our cares, as we release the burden of our soul over to him, knowing that he loves us more than we can fathom. I shared with some of the leaders this morning, it's the great theme of the book of Psalms, is that God's love endures forever. That God loves us more than we can fathom. That God desires to engulf us, to wrap his arms around us more than we can fathom. And what happens when somebody wraps their arms around you? You have this assurance that everything's all right. Think about your own children. I asked you, do you have children? Raise your hand. Most of us raised our hand. When the children don't feel good, when things don't feel right, what do they do? They tend to draw close, and they're wanting you just to wrap your arms around them and to say, you know what? It's okay. It's okay. When they don't feel good, what do they want to do? They just want to lay in your lap. They just want you, I don't know what yours are like, mine want just, they want you to rub their head, their back. It's just that assurance. We were driving in the car yesterday or the day after, and you know, we were kind of squashed in the back seat. I wasn't. The ladies were squashed, and the young ladies were squashed in the back. My youngest was sitting next to my mom, and I don't know what happened, but I think my mom touched her neck or her back, and Kylie said something, well, since your hands are already there, why don't you just go ahead and scratch my back? It's just that comfort, that assurance that we feel. Hear me, church, we can gain that if we choose to rest in the arms of Jesus, knowing how much he loves us. And as we're resting in his arms, he just says, hey, just tell me about your day. Tell me what's going on. Cast your cares upon me, and I'll sustain you. I mean, I'm not going to let the righteous fall. What a beautiful promise. But I gain that. Why? By communion with God. My second in helping us to gain the answer to the struggle of anxiety in our life is the control of thoughts. Look back to Philippians 4. It says, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Hear me, when we begin to control our thoughts through the help of Christ, I believe we can go to bed at night with nothing physically wrong and lie awake hour after hour worrying about tomorrow, about what someone said, or about some personal prestige. Why? Because we've lost control of our thoughts. We're antagonized in our thoughts. We're worked over in our thoughts. Anxiety just begins to build. Worry just begins to build right here between the two ears. We wake up in the middle of the night and I have this thought, I have that thought. I can be late, sitting at my desk throughout the day, and all of a sudden this thought hits me, and I get completely sidetracked, and anxiety just begins to fill my life. But we've got to learn to control the thoughts. Let me give you six helps with this. and controlling of thoughts. I'm talking about the control of the control that limits thoughts, excuse me, to reality. Control that limits thoughts to reality. When the Bible says whatever is true, George, and I'm sure it's the kitchen. If you can still hear me, they're cooking in the kitchen. And I'm sure the steam got the smoke detector. I don't think there's a fire in the church. There we go. Are you still with me? I just wanted to make sure that you're listening, that you're awake. Control that limits thoughts to reality. To reality. The Bible states this, whatever is true. Whatever is true. Hear me, because this is a big answer for many people. Whatever is true. Can I tell you what that excludes? That which is speculative. Many and much of our anxiety is built on speculative. Perceived reality is not always reality. Now, books will tell you the opposite. But we get ourselves in a lot of trouble because we just speculate things. And what we speculate, we believe is true. What you speculate is often not true. Whatever is true, it says, think about such things. We get caught up in speculative things or things, or if not speculative, things that we believe might occur. What might occur, hear me, church, that's not true. At least not yet. So don't allow your minds to drift to such things as speculative thoughts or things that might actually occur or might happen to occur in our lives. We have to be willing to control that control that limits the thoughts to reality. Control number two that limits thoughts to honorable things. Thinking, it says, of honorable things excludes, hear me, excludes unworthy words or deeds of others. Once again, thinking on honorable things. I know this isn't easy. This is a work in process for us, but we often allow our thoughts to go to those unworthy things that might have been said to us. The unhealthy things that might have been said to us. And for some reason, we allow our minds to be captivated by those instead of thinking on those things which are honorable. How do I know this? I've had it happen to me many times in my life. I've done it also in my life. You can be in a conversation with somebody. You can tell them six positive things about themselves, one negative thing, and often the only thing that they'll ever remember is that one negative thing. It's like the six good things that you told them they did. They'll even deny you, even said they'll completely forget about those things. Why? Because we struggle to think on honorable things. We allow our thoughts to be get caught up on unhonorable things, unworthy deeds that maybe have happened within our lives. Control number three that limits thoughts to righteousness. Which again, whatever is true refers to thoughts that are in accordance with eternal and unchangeable righteousness. Eternal and unchangeable righteousness. Control that limits thoughts to righteousness. Number four, control that limits thoughts to purity. Purity, this is big. This excludes a whole area of degrading or disturbing thoughts.
degrading and disturbing thoughts. I've got to get rid of those. I've got to take control of what I think on, what I allow my mind to ponder to. Number five, control that limits thoughts to that which produces love. Thoughts that produce love. There's no room for thoughts of hate, spite, or retribution when your thoughts are motivated by love. Thoughts of love. Lastly, number six, control that limits thoughts, as the Bible would declare, to that which is admirable. Admirable. Things that are winning and attractive are always a good report. Admirable, the Bible says. I love what the scripture says, that I've got to take captive every thought and bring it into obedience of Christ Jesus. I got news for you. I'm not saying this is easy. I don't believe that Jesus lives in the speculative. I don't believe that Jesus lives in what might occur. He lives in that which is true, that which is honorable, that which is righteous, that which is admirable. We need help. I admit, I need help with my thoughts. It's amazing. You know me, I love sports. I've probably given this analogy before. You can walk up, you got a 160-yard shot to the green, and it's a huge old green, but you don't see the green. You don't even see the pin. All you see is the bunker, the water, and everything else around it. That's all you ever see. How do I know? Because every professional golfer has a sports shrink to help them think right. Most great quarterbacks have a sports shrink to help them think right. We struggle. It's just, it's our flesh. We struggle in those thoughts. But I think if we can begin to practice with God's help to take control of those thoughts and bring them in obedience. He says, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, he says, put into practice, and the God of peace. This leads me to my third thought for us, my third revelation, consistency in living. Consistency in living begins to minimize the anxiety within our lives. You may pray and you may control your thoughts and still be eaten with anxiety because you know that your life is inconsistent with your professions. Consistency in living. Look back to verse 9 one more time. Whatever you've learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, the Bible says, put into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. I believe consistency in living imparts a clear conscience. A clear conscience. Paul did. Acts 23. Paul looked straight at the Sanhedrin and said, my brothers, I have fulfilled my duty to God in all good and conscience to this day. You see, I believe a clear conscience can come only when you're faithful to the Lord. When you're faithful to God. His teachings, his practicing. That clear conscience removes those guilty feelings. Removes that worry. I wonder why they're watching me. I wonder what they think of me. I wonder if they'll catch me. I wonder if they saw what I did. But if I have a clear conscience and I'm practicing right living, then I don't have that struggle. I don't have that anxiety that builds up within my life. Consistent living is true to the teachings of Christ. That's what the Apostle Paul, the teachings of Christ that he passed on to the Philippian church. He says, put these into practices. Christ's teachings alone can develop self-respect. Christ's teachings alone can guide us aright. Catch Psalms. We know this. Psalms 119, 105. Your word, Lord, is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I've got to receive the teachings of Christ. I've got to put those into practice and choose to consistently to live these which God has placed within my life. Hear this, consistency in living will also point others to Jesus. Points others
to Jesus.
I want to be the light that Christ has called me to be. Do you know what the number one claim is against believers and why their witness is ineffective? Because unbelievers don't see a difference in how believers live and they live. Inconsistencies in our living. That's the number one charge against believers. Why do I need that? It hasn't done anything for you. Your life is no different than mine. But we want to make these good professions. But oftentimes, evidently, because of the charge, there's no substance to the profession that we make. There needs to be consistency. The Apostle Paul says, put these things into practice. Why? Why? Because it will enable us to be the witness. I don't want somebody else to be distracted or hindered because of my inconsistencies in living a righteous life. Do you hear me this morning, church? Their salvation could be on your hands. And how you live. And how you live. I share this with our leaders. Forgive me for just a moment. I'll wrap it up pretty quickly here. I've only got through 3 of the 5 or 10, but we'll get the other ones quickly. I heard this my whole life growing up. It's an experience from my childhood, but I believe it still works today. I heard a lot of young people that I went to high school saying, well, it must be okay for me to do this because so-and-so does it. My parents do it. My grandparents do this. My youth does this. The deacon at our church does this. Hear me, inconsistency in living ruins your testimony. It's hard to not live in anxiety as a believer when my witness is not effective. Because that's a great calling on our lives. There are things that your pastor doesn't do because he doesn't want to demonstrate an inconsistent lifestyle, and because God has called him to be set apart. Set apart from what? The world. As a believer, God has not called you and saved you to live as close to the world as possible. I believe, hear me this morning carefully, I believe that there is a cheapening of the grace of God in the Church of America. Well, I can do this because I have a freedom in Christ. No, that's not what that says. You've missed it. Well, God will forgive me. Can I give you a thought? God didn't save you to go sin again. Did you hear that? God didn't save you to go sin again. That's cheapening the grace of God. That's growing in our culture today, church. We are living inconsistent lifestyles. That's not what God has called for us. When we are living inconsistently, we naturally grow in anxiety, worry. It consumes our lives. May our lives identify with what God has produced for us, what God has, catch this one more time, whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice. put it into practice, live it. That's what the Apostle Paul is referring to on the teachings of Jesus. And catch this, and the God of peace will be with you. This may sound crazy. So if I'm not putting into practice what God has taught and brought to me, then I might be removing myself from the peace of God. Here, I'll go. Can I go a step? I don't believe that I might be. I will be removing myself from the peace of God. How do I know? Because that's what the Word says. That's what the Word has brought into our lives. We need that consistency in our life. Let me get you to the last two. Number four, in order to overcome, to deal with the anxiety, we need a contentment in God's will. Look at verse 11. Skip ahead with me. I'm not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secrets of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry. Much of our anxiety grows from the inability to be content with God's will. The inability to be content with God's will. Many struggle. We're not content with where God has led us, what God has called us to do in our lives. Can I give you a few thoughts briefly? God's will probably won't meet all of your desires. Well, the Word says that God will give you the desires of your heart. There is a condition to that. That's living within His plan, His purpose, His will for your life. I know what it is to be in need, He says, and I know what it is to have plenty. You see, I think God realizes that our desires, all of our desires, are not necessarily necessities of life. God may not have desired for you to have your own private plane. I hate to break the news to you. God may not desire for you to have a 5,000 square foot house. He may have one in glory for you, but His desire may not be here for you to have that house. Think about this. I think if God actually met all of my desires, think about this about your life. We might have chaos. I mean, think, how do I know this? I'll prove to you that there'd be chaos. There'd be chaos in the sanctuary if God met all of my desires. I just assume the Cowboys win every Super Bowl that ever happens. I think I'd have chaos. Would I not? It's a good thing that God doesn't meet all of our desires. Because the world may be quite chaotic. Thank you. I won't repeat that. God's will may call for personal sacrifice. We don't like sacrifice. We struggle with sacrifice. For Paul to be content in God's will meant for him to be content in personal sacrifice. Not only food, but other aspirations of life had to be surrendered. For instance, he had to give up his life as a Pharisee. All the privileges of being a Pharisee. He had to give this up. Call for sacrifice of noble ideas that are not God's will. A call for sacrifice of time and talent in our Christian service under God's. Why do we struggle with this? It's God's plan. It's God's will. And some of it might be uncomfortable for us. But hear me. I want you to realize that God's will is always best for your life and for my life. Matthew 6:33 says, "But seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you as well." God knows what we need. We just got to allow ourselves to seek after Him, to run after Him with everything inside of us. God's will leads us to fewer problems. Fewer problems, less problems means less anxiety. Because often the problems create the anxiety
within our lives.
And God's will is that we would just allow ourselves to be wrapped up within His arms, living for Him. Lastly, number five, as the Christian answer to anxiety, confidence in Christ. Confidence in Christ. I'm going to conclude this, EJ, if you'll help me out.
I heard this scripture my whole life growing up. I've passed it on to my children.
Philippians 4:13.
I read it, but I would never even have to read it because I probably have heard it at least 10 million times in my life.
I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. It's through Christ. It's not in me.
It's through Christ. You see, I believe a great deal of our anxiety stems from our failure to realize that we're probably not as important as we think we are. It's not that we're not important to Jesus. We're of utmost importance to Him. Please don't misunderstand me.
But we do a great job of just puffing our own selves up, building our own selves up.
It's helped me, and I want to pass it on to you.
What do I mean by that? I'm not in charge of my life. We like to run our life. We like to dictate our life. But I and all of us have to come to the reality that I'm not in charge. God is. God is. I've surrendered. I've chosen to surrender my life to Him. It's not my life, but it's Jesus. Michael, it's not about people seeing Jerry. It's about people seeing Jesus. It's not about Jerry doing great things. It's about people seeing the great things that Jesus does. It's not about people seeing Cornerstone Church. It's about people seeing Jesus. We get caught up into puffing ourselves up. Well, I got to be bigger. I've got to do bigger things. Our church has got to be bigger. No. Hear me. Catch this. Nowhere in the Great Commission, our culture has lost this. It's corrupted mindsets of a lot of great believers. Nowhere in God's Word does God say, go. I've empowered you to be my witness. Now go and build big churches. Anybody read that in God's Word? But everybody wants to be a part of the big church. They want their church to be bigger and to bigger. You know what God says? Go and make disciples. Now, will the church grow when you make disciples? It's going to have to grow. But we've lost focus. Why? Because we're trying to run the show. We're just about it being bigger. And God says, oh, no. No, I said go and make disciples. You know what making disciples is? I don't mean this bad, but it takes time. It gets ugly sometimes. Because we all got junk we got to work through, that we got to grow through. We all got stuff in our lives. And trying to help somebody through that process is not always pretty. It takes an effort. It takes personal sacrifice. It takes a commitment and laying aside some of my personal desires. It laying aside some of my good enjoyments of life. Why? Because God commissioned that I go and make a disciple. And after I make a disciple, what do? Do I just throw my hands up, throw my feet up in the easy chair and flip the TV on? No. He says, go and make another disciple. and then go and make another disciple. That takes personal sacrifice. That takes personal investments. That's taking a confidence in Christ, because I'm going to be honest. There's sometimes I look at somebody and I just being honest, my thought is, God, I don't know how I can help them. And I feel God just kind of like saying, hey, you're not the one changing them. I just told you to go love them. I'll take care of the other stuff. Because he's the one in charge. I have to have a confidence, not in myself, but a confidence in Christ. I'm gonna give you just two thoughts here real quick, three thoughts, I'm sorry. A confidence in Christ renews our self-determination. A confidence in Christ, number two, removes the fear of failure. And lastly, number three, a confidence in Christ renders yourself as God's instrument. Let me give them to you one more time, the three of them. A confidence in Christ renews self-determination. A confidence in Christ removes the fear of failure. A confidence in Christ renders yourself as God's instrument. For I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. Through Christ. It was imparted into my life, and I've tried to impart it into my children's life. Whenever there's a struggle, I can do all things through Christ. I've heard Renee pass it on to our girls. I can do all things through Christ. It's through Jesus, knowing who I am in Christ. God desires that we not live a life of anxiety. He's given us help. 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 Communion with him. Controlling the thoughts. A confidence in who he is. A contentment in his will. Trusting in him. Believing in him. God is here. God is for you today, church. God desires to lead you. God desires to strengthen you. God desires to enable your life. God desires to wrap his arms around you and say, fear not. Fear not. He even says, in this world you will have trouble, but fear not. Why? Because I am with you. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'll walk with you through every storm of life. I'll walk with you through every trouble of life. Hear me. He identifies that we'll have this storm. He identifies that we'll have this struggle. Yet he says, yet will I stand with you. Why? I'll sustain you because I desire that the righteous would not fall. That the righteous would not fall. God does not want you to fall. God doesn't want you to give your life over to anxiety. But he's for you. Would you stand to your feet with